The whole thing started in St. Thomas around the 80s years. I don't know exactly, but around. So what happened, there was this woman who got a shoulder surgery and the clavicular surgery. And in the therapy, they gave her a ball to squeeze. Now, what does that do to the shoulder? Very little. So first I made her walk up and down the wall in front of her with the fingers and then sideways with the fingers up and down. But then it occurred to me that the shoulder needs circularity of movement. So I put a nail in the wall and attached a string so that first she could make small circles and then big circles. And bigger and bigger. So that was the therapy that I gave her. And also I made her walk in between the doors with the fingers so that both hands are working parallel and up and down and then in a circle on the wall like that. But this made it precise with the string. So this is important for the past because how it happened later that I adopted all of this into the equipment. So what has happened, after many years, I moved back to New York, and then one day, I already opened my studio, and I've been teaching yoga for dancers, the one that I developed in St. Thomas for over 6 years. So I had a good past in movement. Besides that, you know that I have been a gymnast and a swimmer in my youth. So all of that contributed into the action of the equipment. So that how it happened. One day I have found two bar stools on the street. Somebody threw them out. And I said, hey, I can do something with it. Maybe I can do a pirouette machine or something, because in my mind, I already worked on those imaginarily. But then as I started working, moving with my hands in this bicycle, instantaneously, the arching curl was born, then the figure eights. This was instantaneous, within a second. But now, how do I put this thing into an action? How do I make a machine? Then in my memory, I remembered this thing, how I worked with the string around the nail and so on and in between the doors. So I said, maybe I can put two of these revolving chairs on the wall, two of them in between a door, two of them down on the floor so I can do something with my legs. So this was the first idea. But then I said, how about if I put the whole thing somehow together? So I started imagining how it would be if it would be together and it opens and it closes and it goes down and it goes up. So it took me a few months, of course, of elaboration in my mind. And I never worked with material with my hands. So I didn't know what to do. I started going into Canal Street, that is a place where they sell all kind of junk and everything you can find. So I started looking for reels, for all kinds of things, whatever I can. And I started building my first piece of equipment. And but then, being a dancer, I said, "Hey, I need a jumping board, because for a dancer, jumping is the most important element, one of them." And I figured out how to put a platform that it is rolling back and forth on skate rails and against the wall first, push away, and then I put some springs to pull me back and so on. And then I thought, how about a leg extension unit? But the old-fashioned leg extension made your leg short and bulky and it didn't work. I say it has to extend with the leg. So I started philosophizing on that. So eventually, these three things came together. And this is how I got my first patent. My first patent is on the jumping board with the leg extension unit and the gyro toner that comes up and down and moves in all directions. And so, of course, I had to go through all kinds of learning process of how to build these things. And after 30, 40, or I don't know how many models, it is what it is today. But then how did I come with the idea for the pulley tower? Because I needed, so originally I wanted to put up rings in the back room over there somehow. But then how do people can move with the rings when they have no strength, especially dancers, they are very weak. So how about if I can make this ring somehow to come down and up? So to make the story short, I have built a 4x4 up against the wall and against the floor, and I put two reels on the top and a string that goes around with the weight, and I started pulling it back and forth and imitating the exercises that I would have done with the ring. Yeah, but then I figured out figure eights, the twist and pull and so on. But then as I pulled really fast, the weight started jumping and falling. So I said, this is no good. So that's when I started thinking to create a transition where it slows down the weight. So this triple loop, what I created, it makes the weight move slow when I am moving fast. And it allows a shorter range of strings in order to make long movements with it. So this is how the pulley tower was born. And then how to connect all of that, this is the story in a short. But the story is exactly as it is. In between, of course, many years passed and all kind of experimentation. And this is how the equipment was born. I had no idea now what to do with anything. So I started building my first thing just with a jigsaw and a rasp and sandpaper. That was all. That's how it started. But then I bought all kind of other equipment. I started experimenting and I became incredibly handy. Somehow my hands understood something and of course followed my brains. And my brains understood something as well. So taking all the experiences from swimming and gymnastics and ballet, and then all the Kundalini experiences that culminated in the Yoga for Dancers, I had an incredible background in movement orientation and the need of the body where it wants to move and how it should move. And so that is how it became gyrotonic expansion system. The movements already existed, and I have seen it in space. I've seen it how the body has to move. And then I just had to create the actual equipment. And it started slow, but somehow, as I said, my hands started understanding how to work with wood, how to use machinery. And eventually I have built about 400 single-handedly and started selling them until I had to give it over to Balanced Body because I could not continue. When the demand went up to 100 a year, I could not keep up with that anymore. I had two helpers, but those two helpers were as ignorant as I am. So they have been doing the sending, the putting the boxes together and just cutting simple things. I did all the design and the instructions and so on. But between the three of us, we did a good job. Their name are Jacek and Vacek. They are from Poland. And their father worked in the building where I had my workshop. And that's how I got to know them. And they asked me, hey, can we do something with, they didn't even speak the language. So I started communicating hands and feet and grimacing and so on. But it worked really well. They were extraordinary. They worked with me for like about 3 or maybe even 4 years. For me, it was very important for those who did gyrotonic to understand how even how to work with the wood, because I brought them in, okay, let me see how would you sand the wood and if you can feel the blemishes underneath the sandpaper. And of course, they started sanding like everybody else. And I said, no, you work with the body, smooth, back and forth, and long movements, and then feel the wood underneath your hand, because short movements, you just create holes and ditches and digs, and nothing is going to be smooth and long. And learning how to work with the body on the wood, you learn how to work your body on its own as well. So, and also to feel other people's body when it is working too short and it is not moving large enough, long enough, then you short, any kind of short movement back and forth, it creates the same effect in the body. So I started teaching them gyrotonic by painting the wood, just like in Karate Kid, you know, painting all kinds of straps and doing odd jobs just to learn, understand that how the manual work is no different from anything else. So it was a very simple exchange. It was mostly for the learning and to see what goes into what I am putting out as equipment. Yeah. So how the actual gyrotonic methodology worked even there. Well, dreams are a very important part, because what I did, usually I went in the evening or before going to sleep with all these thoughts in my mind, creating and visualizing and imagining. And then in many, many dreams, the solution came because I put out the questions, I put out the vision, but I didn't have the answer. And many, many times the answer came either in the dream or right upon awakening. The moment I woke up, I suddenly saw resolutions. And then I just have to put it in practice. So imagination is a very important thing, and to create a space for something to come in, you have to put out the questions a million times, and the questions have to be very deep and with feeling. Otherwise, you don't create a vacuum or a space for an answer to come in. And once I saw that this is happening, I actually made a conscious effort. So whenever I needed an answer to something, I put it out very deeply before going to sleep. And then not always came the first day or the next day or the third day. Some things I had to be waiting for even 20 years. But I've been putting out the question again and again and again, and I don't give up. And eventually the answer came. Not really, because now I don't have such deep desires anymore, you know. It is now I am enjoying what I have built and created, and I work with it. So when I'm teaching, but I don't really need new answers. Everything is somehow formulated itself and is complete enough. I still work, do experiment on things. Right now I'm experimenting with a form of aerobic exercising. And I do it every day, but not as deeply as before. It is more like a playtime now. The process is never ending, but as I'm saying, it is not as burning and is not as arduous. So it becomes a little bit easier and more like a playtime. Finally, as it should be, really, everything should be playfully experienced. Luckily, I never had any traumas because of it, or I never blamed anybody, or it's too hard, no, everything was always okay. And I did it happily, and that was a very good thing. So how it happened, I worked out an original system all for dancers, all geared for dancers. But then word of mouth, my neighbor, my father, my friend, I don't know, they also want to do it, but they are not dancers. So I have to start modifying the exercises so it is available for them. Then they started bringing in sick people with problems, this and that. And I had to modify it even more. And I kept modifying and modifying and modifying according to what came to me. So I always worked with the people who needed something. Yeah. My question always was, what is that you want to attain? What is that you want? Flexibility, strength, vitality, agility. Tell me what you want. And then I tell you how much time you need for that, according to what I see from you. And then see if you want to put that time in or not. And so success came very, very fast because those who agreed to the what I asked them, they got good results. The equipment can adjust to anything because it has an adjustable breadth and adjustable height and adjustable everything. So I adjust the equipment according to the person's need. It's so simple. It's so simple because what I say always, if you can move your head this much, that is later on becomes this much. If you can look up and if you can look down, that's the beginning of an arch and curl. So if you can move your fingers, eventually you can move your wrist. Then eventually you move your elbow with your wrist. Then eventually move your shoulder and everything else together, right? So you have to start with what's available and then you move from there, no matter how minuscule that is. And you can modify it to everybody's needs, everybody's. If you really look at it well, it is built like a human body. It has the proportions. If the middle, if you look at it, is the spine. The two moving elements, the cables, are representing one arm and the other arm. The legs, if you look at that, the support of the equipment, it looks like a human leg. So this is why people don't understand at first what they perceive, but they perceive it somewhere on the subconscious level. And those curvatures imitate the body's curvatures, so naturally it has an appeal that is specific for the pulley tower that is built like the human body. The others, I experiment with lines and curves, and if I like it, I believe other people will like it too, but first I have to like it myself, and I really have to like it. I totally believe in that. but I cannot prove it. But certainly, when you have an object that you work with, even a pen, if it is beautiful to your eyes, and you will write more beautiful with it than just with a stick or something like that, right? Your clothes, you wear it differently if you really, really like it and you believe it is beautiful than if I put just a sack on my body or something like that. So beauty has a meaning, but everybody, of course, has a different relation to different beauty and what it is beautiful. But some beautiful things are appeal to many, many, many people. And then others appeal to many others, and so on. So I have a large audience for my, what I created, my beauty, and I like that. I had many, many emotional outbursts from people crying and just all kinds of emotion coming up. So I had to adjust also the modified exercises according to that level, because if you open up too much at first, I had one woman, I remember, I've been showing the arch and curl, and the moment she went down and this way, she stopped and started crying because the heart center started working immediately. So the stimulation reached immediately the moment she opened like that. So it depends on what center is stimulated more that you have similar experiences. For instance, people came back and said, gee, I went home and I felt so aroused because, I don't know. Well, you have stimulated the lower center by moving the pelvis back and forth. Yeah, but that is a healthy thing. It awakes your energy and then you move it around in the body to become health. You have to move your energy. It cannot stagnate. So depending on which center is stimulated more and what energy is more suppressed over there, that is going to come out first. And then you have to go beyond, that disappears, and what remains is a good will and good feeling. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Many, many people who've been doing the gyrokinesis, when they started working with the equipment, they started understanding better because the equipment guides you. For instance, give you an example. The circles with the handle, it is so equal that it creates an equal ripple back into the body. Now, if you work freehand and your circle is like this, the same thing goes back into your body. So the chaos that you express outwardly, that chaos also going to reflect inwardly. But in a perfect circle, there is no chaos. So this perfection also starts rippling back into the body. For instance, you push against the wall with 5 pounds, 5 pounds is going back into the body. 10 pounds push, 10 pounds is going back. Now, if I push 50 pounds and my shoulder cannot take it, then I create an injury. Because you have to know how much to push in order to support inwardly. So everything have an inside effect as well as outside.